Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Philly Special, the inside story of how the Philadelphia Eagles won their first Super Bowl championship, by Sal Paolantonio, narrated by Barry Abrams. The job is not to make simple things complicated, but to make complicated things comprehensible. In other words, what's really going on here? Arthur Miller. Prologue. The 2017 Philadelphia Eagles were a great team, but they were an even better story. It's the story of how a star-crossed NFL franchise defied the critics and the oddsmakers, won its first Super Bowl title, and became America's team. Several days after it happened, former NFL wide receiver Nate Burleson said on NFL Network, "It's a movie." Yes, you could say that. But it was all too real. I saw it with my own eyes. I had a front row seat the whole way. In short, I lived it. What follows is the inside story of how it really happened. For me, the highlight of the story came just minutes after Tom Brady's Hail Mary pass to tight end Rob Gronkowski fell harmlessly to earth at U.S. Bank Stadium in Minneapolis on Sunday, February 4th. NFL Commissioner Roger Goodell handed Eagles owner Jeffrey Lurie the Lombardi Trophy. Green and white confetti were shot into the air with hydraulic cannons and cascaded onto the players and coaches and their families. Doug Pederson slowly descended from the national television riser and found me waiting at the bottom of the steps. Here we were, two guys who live just a mile or so from one another in the small town of Moorestown, New Jersey, which is about 15 miles from the Eagles' home stadium, Lincoln Financial Field in South Philadelphia. At that moment, we seemed to be suspended at the confluence of our careers and history, with hundreds of cameras and reporters from all over the world surrounding us, talking to one another about how the Eagles did it, beat the mighty New England Patriots, and won their first Super Bowl title. We looked at each other, the camera rolling. A moment frozen in time and bright lights. Then, my instincts just took over. I knew I had just a few minutes before Pederson's NFL escort was going to yank him away from me. So, I discarded the pleasantries and just did my job. I asked him a question. "Doug," I began, "you said all along this would be a 60-minute game. It would come down to the end. How did you do it?"
"It's just a resilient group, Sal," he said. "They battled all year long. I just made my mind up to stay aggressive all the way throughout the game. Trust our players. Trust our quarterback. Trust our players to make plays."
Oh boy, was he aggressive. In the annals of Super Bowl head coaches, Pederson may go down as the greatest gambler ever, and I know exactly where that came from. I remember talking with Pederson the morning of his first regular season game, Sunday, September 11th, 2016. His father, Gordon, who was his mentor and taught him the game of football, had passed away in Monroe, Louisiana, just 9 days earlier. It was a tough 9 days for Doug, his wife Jeannie, and their family, burying the patriarch of the Pederson family, the man who infused family, church, and football into the fabric of their lives, was not going to be there when his son put on the headset on an NFL sideline as the head coach of a pro football team for the first time. In fact, Pederson had missed part of the week of preparation to attend the funeral and be with his mom Terry, brother David, and sister Kathy in Louisiana. So Pederson was about to take the field in his professional debut with a hole in his heart. That morning, the Eagles' public relations staff had warned me that I only had time for 3 questions. Talking to an NFL head coach before the game at the stadium is pretty rare. It happens maybe once or twice a season. Got to be a coach who's pretty comfortable dealing with the media. Let's put it this way, it's not something Patriots coach Bill Belichick would ever agree to do. Pederson is the polar opposite. But still, it was his first game. I can tell you for a fact, having covered the NFL for 25 years, that just doesn't happen. I asked Doug about the game, then his talking points to the team. but I had to ask him about his father's passing. I knew it was touchy, but if I didn't ask it, I would be derelict in the basic duty of journalism. He was ready for it. "Doug," I said, "what advice do you think your dad would give you this morning?"
"He would say, 'Son, be yourself, but stay aggressive. Always stay aggressive,'" Pederson replied.
Covering his tenure for 2 years, I always came back to that interview as a guidepost to understanding Pederson's go-for-it mentality in his first year as the Eagles' head coach, an approach that was perfectly suited for his rookie quarterback Carson Wentz, the young buck from North Dakota who took the franchise and the NFL by storm in 2016. Pederson was often criticized for going for it too often on fourth down in 2016. The chorus of complaints on Philadelphia's two vibrant sports talk radio stations was brutal. He was called misguided and foolhardy. And worse, much, much worse. But in retrospect, he was setting the foundation that would allow him to remain aggressive throughout the championship season of 2017, including going 2-for-2 on fourth down in Super Bowl 52. The night before Super Bowl Sunday, I was the only reporter invited into the Eagles team hotel, the Radisson Blue, on the south end of the Mall of America. The layers of security were brutal. The feds were concerned about terrorists. The local cops were deathly afraid of a renegade local gunman. The Eagles security staff was worried about one thing: Belichick stealing a look, a hint, a tendency, anything that gave the Patriots an edge. But there's time for a full examination of that later in this book. Pederson and I met in the lobby for a long interview for SportsCenter. As a small gift of appreciation for his time and candor all year long, I brought him his favorite dessert, a pint of Häagen-Dazs vanilla ice cream. I asked him if he would be channeling his father on Super Bowl Sunday.
"I'll definitely be thinking about him," he said. "I'll be thinking about what he told me."
Which brings us to the most famous and successful fourth down play in Super Bowl history, the Philly Special. Now, I want you to think about this for a minute. NFL coaches by nature are conservative. They rarely go for it on fourth down. But going for it on fourth down on the 1 yard line in the Super Bowl, running a play that's never been tried in the 52-year history of the Super Bowl, a play that your team has never tried before in a game? That's being aggressive. In the streets, in the locker room, they have another nickname for that brand of chutzpah. Let's just say on Super Bowl Sunday, Doug Pederson decided to wear his big boy pants. The Philly Special was a reverse toss to a tight end who throws a pass to the quarterback leaking out of the line of scrimmage into the end zone. And it starts with a direct snap to an undrafted rookie running back, Wisconsin's Corey Clement, who went to Glassboro High School, which is South Jersey rival to Moorestown, where Pederson's kids go to school. Now that's a wow. So here are the particulars. 38 seconds left in the half, the Eagles had 4th and 1. Even though the Patriots had just scored, Philadelphia had the lead 15-12. So Pederson could have kicked a field goal, gone up 18-12, and nobody would have questioned him. But Peterson's defense was failing him, and he knew it. They could not stop Tom Brady, and would not stop him until late in the game, which Pederson had no way of knowing. During a timeout, quarterback Nick Foles came to the sideline and looked at Pederson, who held the laminated play sheet over his mouth. Foles said, "Philly, Philly?" Pederson knew what he meant. Philly Special, a play that the Eagles had practiced for 4 weeks and were going to run against the Minnesota Vikings in the NFC Championship game before deciding the Vikings might sniff it out because the Chicago Bears, their division rival, had run it. This time, Pederson just said, "Yes, let's do it." That simple. Foles went to the huddle and said just two words, "Philly Special." At the line of scrimmage, he yelled, "Kill, kill," and moved slightly to his right, right behind right tackle Lane Johnson. Clement took the direct snap, ran to his left, and tossed the football like a loaf of bread to tight end Trey Burton, who had been a high school quarterback in Florida. Burton threw a perfect spiral to Foles, who crept into the end zone like a thief disappearing into the night. Foles, who played high school basketball in Texas, has big, soft hands. He's caught many passes in the low post.
It seemed like the ball would never get there, Foles told me. All I kept telling myself is, focus on the ball. I knew I was already in the end zone and all alone. That's who I am, said Pederson. That's my alter ego. That's my evil twin, I guess. I learned that from my dad, his aggressiveness with us growing up. I want every play scoring touchdowns and every defensive play losing 5 yards. I may come off as soft-spoken to you guys, but inside, I want to win the game. Not at an all-cost expense, but pretty close. When you're playing the Patriots, Bill Belichick, Tom Brady, if you're not playing aggressive, you're going to lose those games. I made my mind up after the Vikings game. I knew we were playing the Patriots. I was going to have to maintain that aggressiveness in the football game. The pressure of the game was not going to change who I am.
The touchdown shocked the world. Burton became the first tight end in NFL history to throw a touchdown pass in a Super Bowl, and Foles became the first quarterback to catch a touchdown pass in a Super Bowl. More important, the call and its execution announced to the Patriots they were in a fight, and it proclaimed to the Eagles players standing with Pederson that he entrusted them to win the most important game of any of their lives, particularly Foles. Remember, this is the guy who replaced a player who had reached mythical Paul Bunyan-esque status in just 29 NFL starts, Carson Wentz. Foles needed to know that Pederson trusted him. Make no mistake about that. Since December 10th, when Wentz blew out his knee in Los Angeles, Pederson's trust in Foles never publicly wavered, even while Foles' game went through the natural ebb and flow of a late in-season replacement quarterback. A little history here. Since the Super Bowl era began in 1970, this kind of thing had only happened once before. In 1990, New York Giants quarterback Phil Simms suffered a freak foot injury after his team had accumulated 11 wins. He was replaced by Jeff Hostetler, who won 3 postseason games, including Super Bowl 25 in Tampa, when Scott Norwood's kick sailed wide right and the Buffalo Bills lost their best chance at a world title. The Giants, an NFC East team, beat the Bills, an AFC East team, just like the Eagles over the Patriots. But that's where the comparison breaks down. Remember, that Giants team was coached by Bill Parcells, who had already won a Super Bowl title with New York and was on his way to the Hall of Fame. His defensive coordinator that day was Bill Belichick, who would go on to win 5 more Super Bowl titles with the Patriots and is on his way to Canton. And that team had Hall of Famer Lawrence Taylor and the best defense of its time. No one is prepared to say that Pederson will end up a Hall of Famer, yet. Remember, when Pederson was brought on to replace Chip Kelly in 2016, USA Today ranked him dead last of the 7 NFL head coaching hires that year. Dead last. 3 of those coaches have since been fired. The other 3 had losing records in 2017. And the 2017 Eagles defense was good, but not historically good. So what Foles did was far more difficult than what Hostetler accomplished. Indeed, you could say it was unprecedented. By making that Philly special call, Pederson told everybody, the team, 100 million television viewers, and the Patriots defense, that he believed in Foles.
That play call said to all of us, "We got this, to the bitter end," safety Malcolm Jenkins said.
Foles, the MVP of Super Bowl 52, had done what many quarterbacks had tried to do for the Eagles franchise and its fan base, bring home the Lombardi Trophy. 4 days after the game, the day before the biggest championship parade in the city's history, I had a quiet moment with Foles outside the Eagles' locker room at the team's NovaCare Complex practice facility in South Philly. "Nick," I said to him, "I hope you know what you've done. You've erased 3 generations of doubt and disappointment and disrespect, not only for this team and franchise, but for a community of people, millions of fans around this area and all over the country who have waited for this moment. He just looked at me, soaked it all in. I knew he got it. I continued, "Just from my perspective, I've covered this team for 25 years, trying to tell the story of this quest. That's a lot of road trips, a lot of Sundays away from my family, a lot of sacrifice that my family made for me to be with this team. So for my family, there is certainly elation and closure. You did it for all those families out there who I can tell you are feeling the same thing." He reached out and hugged me and said, "That's awesome." "Yes, it is," I said. "Thank you." And then literally 30 minutes later, in an auditorium on the other side of the building, Pederson ruined that touchy-feely moment. Pederson proclaimed that the team was not done, the story was not over, that we were all not going anywhere.
"Get used to this," Pederson said. "Get used to playing football in February. This is the new norm. This is just the beginning."
So, that's where we shall start this Eagles championship story. At the beginning. Part 1. Welcome to Wentzylvania. Chapter 1. The Wentz Wagon Hits the Road. The Eagles at the Redskins. Sunday, September 10th, 2017, Landover, Maryland. "The dude is a stud." That's what Nick Foles said about Carson Wentz. On Sunday, September 10th, 2017, before he would transform himself into a full-blown NFL stud, before he would become the leading candidate for league MVP in just his second year in the league, before he would lead the Philadelphia Eagles on the most implausible 9-game winning streak anybody could contemplate, Carson Wentz would have to do something he did not do once in his entire rookie season: win a division game on the road. It was one of those swampy, humid, early September mornings in the suburbs of the nation's capital, and Wentz was wearing big designer headphones, listening to gospel music, running along the sidelines of FedEx Field, getting ready for a game that his head coach Doug Pederson was about to tell his team was vitally important if the Eagles were going to make any kind of trouble in the always volatile NFC East. The Eagles, Washington Redskins, New York Giants, and Dallas Cowboys have traded division titles on and off for the last 13 seasons. Indeed, the NFC East has been the only division in the NFL without a repeat title winner during that time. In short, the division is the dictionary definition of dog-eat-dog in professional football. And step one to winning a division title, to making the playoffs, win on the road week one in Washington. Wentz, who has the bow-legged gallop of a wild mare, finished the individual and team drills and sprinted with his teammates and the coaching staff to the visitors' locker room. The chief of Eagles security, Dom DeSandro, known as Big Dom because he looks like he could be the bouncer at any high-end Manhattan nightclub, closed the door behind them. And that's when Doug Pederson began laying down the law. His speech was passionate, but to the point. He gave the 2017 Eagles 3 marching orders.
"Okay," he said, "we've got to do something we didn't do very well last year. We've got to start fast. We talked about it all summer. Start fast, finish strong."
In 2016, Pederson and Wentz stormed onto the scene with 3 straight wins to start the season, but then tailed off badly, losing 6 of 8 games in November and December that doomed the promise of both their rookie campaigns. The Eagles made a habit of getting off to dismal starts and playing from behind. That forced the team to rely more and more on Wentz as a passer and a runner, and it was clearly too much for him. Remember, he had last played at North Dakota State, a notch below Division I college football. He had never before been tested like this physically and mentally. The city, the team, the league had fallen in love with number 11. His jersey was near the top of all sellers in the NFL, alongside Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers, and J.J. Watt. But he couldn't carry the team alone. Indeed, after the season was over, Pederson had told Wentz to
"put down the football and get away from the game for a while,"
to rest his mind and body. Wentz had heard about the all-consuming nature of the football fans in Philadelphia. He thought he was ready for it. He was not. At times it overwhelmed him, especially when he thought it was time to get rededicated to the only task that mattered, winning the city's first Super Bowl title. "It's cool," he said. He said he and his teammates and family have talked about it a lot. "You've read about it, and everyone's talking about it nonstop. And then, playing for a full season, it was real. I was a part of it. I told the story last year when Nelson Aguilar dropped the ball in practice and they booed him at open practice. I was like, all right, this is real, the real deal." But Wentz also remembers the last game of 2016 on New Year's Day. The Cowboys were in town. Both teams were out of the playoffs. "The place was packed," said Wentz. "I'll always remember that." "Are they hard?" referring to the fans. "Sometimes. That's part of it. But I wouldn't have it any other way." Pederson's advice after the 2016 had worked, but now the head coach was asking Wentz to reignite that early 2016 fire and propel this team to another fast start.
"And we got to play with passion," Pederson continued in his team meeting. "We gotta want it for 60 minutes, especially when the other team gets tired in the fourth quarter. We got to bring the passion."
Pederson finished with a warning.
"I want to see how we respond when a little adversity comes."
Looking back on how the 2017 season played out, it's quite amazing that Pederson's first three talking points to what would become a championship team were exactly what needed to be said and would carry through all 16 games of the regular season, the playoffs, and Super Bowl 52. His teams would start fast, play with passion, and be challenged by a historical level of adversity, beginning with the first game of the year against a gnarly Redskins team that had just as much to prove. Not everybody was all in on Carson Wentz year two. Not by a long shot. There were three major unresolved issues: mechanics, a lack of accuracy on his long ball, and durability. Wentz was exposing his body too much, taking too many hits. All of those question marks were raised during one single play against the Redskins, who were on a five-game winning streak against the Eagles. Philadelphia had not beaten Washington since September 21, 2014, 37-34. And the last win in Washington was the September before that, 33-27. These games were always one-score battles of attrition. And I had a ground-level view. As luck would have it, I got the last-minute assignment to be the ESPN radio sideline reporter for this game. My broadcast partners were the incomparable Adam Amin and the Hall of Famer Bill Polian, a former six-time NFL Executive of the Year. When you're on the sideline, you get to hear, feel, see, and smell the game in a completely different way. An NFL game is a carnival of color and anger, an often confusing collision of bumper cars without the cars. It's a fully engaged symphony, an orchestration that requires instant improvisation based on what the coaches and players see and experience. It's a chess match with one important difference. The other guy is trying to knock you out. The American game of football, especially at the NFL level, is the last team sport on earth where it is legislatively okay to commit a violent act.
"Your job is to take the other man down," said former Baltimore Ravens linebacker Ray Lewis, who was inducted into the Hall of Fame in the summer of 2018. "Take him down to the ground. Take him down violently. And take away the football violently. It's an act of violence. And in an act of violence, a man will eventually get hurt."
But football is also a game of specifically designed movements, a syncopation of timed events within clearly delineated spaces. It's not a mass movement game like soccer or basketball or rugby. Timing is critical, until it's not. That's when a player just has to go out and make a play. It's a cliche, but it's true. The team with the best players almost always wins. And there is nothing more important in the game of improvisation than what happens between a quarterback and a wide receiver on a deep pass down the field. The quarterback has to have the right technique, footwork, and release of the ball. The ball has to have the right trajectory. The wide receiver has to have the right release off the snap. The slightest hesitation or interference from a defensive back can ruin the timing. A second lost here or there, and the connection is doomed. NFL teams such as the Eagles practice throwing the ball deep hundreds of times in spring practices, in training camp, in preseason games, practice during the week, pregame warm-ups, until it all becomes second nature, until the muscle memory is so familiar it's like taking the dog for a walk or eating a bowl of Cheerios. And even then, it's often a miracle if it all works seamlessly in the game. It was the Eagles' first offensive play from scrimmage, first and 10 from their own 44-yard line. Wide receiver Torrey Smith, a brilliant off-season acquisition by Vice President for Football Operations Howie Roseman, who had already won a Super Bowl in Baltimore, had beaten the loudmouthed Redskins cornerback Josh Norman right down the middle of the field, a seam route that had given Wentz fits the previous year. With Smith screaming toward the end zone wide open, Wentz had a clear shot. He took it, but the ball never got there, and Smith never had a chance. The same deep ball mechanics that he had spent all offseason to correct and looked polished in training camp and the preseason did not come back to the Eagles' second-year quarterback. Pederson would later say that Wentz's foot slipped. His foot does slip a little, but not enough from my vantage point, and then watching it on tape, to justify such an underthrown pass. Wentz simply did not drive the football where it needed to be. Even though he established the team's all-time rookie record with 379 completions in 2016, routinely hitting the deep ball was something that plagued him, especially as the year wore on. There were questions about whether he had developed elbow soreness, which was never established. He did clearly seem tired. And why not? Wentz had thrown 607 passes in his rookie year, the second most attempts of any rookie quarterback in league history. Only Andrew Luck threw more in his rookie year, 627 in 2012. And look what happened to Luck. He was beaten and battered and wound up with his shoulder shredded, needing surgery that kept him out of football in 2017. In the offseason, to adjust his mechanics, Wentz worked out with Adam Dedeau, the quarterback whisperer and motion mechanics instructor at 3DQB on the West Coast. From what I saw in spring practices, the fine-tuning worked. The ball came out more quickly, and he seemed to be opening up his front foot so that he could push off with more power and authority with the back foot.
"I like what I see," Pederson told me at the time. "He's driving the deep ball better."
Dick Vermeil, the former Eagles head coach who took the team to its first Super Bowl appearance in 1980 and watched Wentz all summer, told me this. "Carson Wentz has the potential to be one of the truly great ones. I mean truly great. Number one area of improvement I want to see this year is his accuracy downfield, and he needs receivers who make all the catches, even the tough ones." Well, Roseman provided two of those, Smith and Alshon Jeffrey, a veteran free agent from Chicago. But if the pass was going to be that inaccurate, there was no way the receivers could make up the difference. After the ball got away from him against Washington, Wentz was visibly upset, and Pederson could sense it immediately. On the very next play, the Redskins beat the Eagles' offensive line, and Wentz took a nasty hit and sack. Pederson told me he had a decision to make: call a running play on 3rd and 12 and hope for the best, then punt, or stay aggressive. He chose option 2. Wentz slid into the shotgun. He eluded the rush. This is what would be both his signature move and drive everybody crazy. On this play, he bought just the right amount of time and threw a laser at wide receiver Nelson Aguilar, who had been plagued by drops in 2016 when the Eagles led the league with 31 dropped passes. Aguilar snagged the pass and pirouetted and found his way to the end zone. In all, 58 yards and a touchdown. Eagles 7, Redskins nothing. Start fast, play with passion, respond to adversity. All three boxes checked. In one play. on the first offensive possession of the first quarter of the first game. And it was sweet redemption for Aguilar, whose heart and commitment to the game had been severely criticized and questioned in 2016, leading Pederson to wonder whether Aguilar was worth saving. But new wide receivers coach Mike Groh, the son of legendary Bill Parcells acolyte Al Groh, worked him hard over the summer and built his confidence. After the game, Pederson would tell me,
"You've got to take these shots. If you're struggling offensively, or you're just not moving the ball, and the defense sees that, and they start crowding the box with 8 or 9 guys, then you're sunk. You got to take shots to loosen everybody up, the defense and your own team. Give them a scare. Give us some confidence that no matter what happens, we're going to play football."
And a lot did happen in this game, but the Eagles kept playing football. I was on the sideline, wearing ESPN radio headphones, standing about 15 yards from Pederson, when Ronald Darby, right in front of the Eagles bench, crumpled to the turf. Initially, my view of the play and the player was blocked, but I could hear Darby's agony, and I could see the stunned faces of his teammates. Darby's right ankle was a twisted mess. Safety Malcolm Jenkins, the leader of the defense, kneeled. On the sideline, there was shock and disgust, the look that said, "Is this how this season is going to go?" Darby was making his first start in an Eagles uniform, and he looked fluid and quick, just what Roseman wanted when he traded with his old nemesis, Buffalo Bills head coach Sean McDermott, to obtain Darby, shipping wide receiver Jordan Matthews to the Bills in a risky swap. Matthews was Wentz's best friend on the team. On the day of the trade, just before the season started, Wentz and several other teammates, tight end Zach Ertz, safety Chris Maragos, and linebacker Jordan Hicks, drove Matthews to Philadelphia International Airport to say goodbye. There were no tears, just a lot of prayers. The four of them attend services and Bible study in the same church in Cherry Hill, New Jersey, where the motto is, "God's vision for each of us is unique," a sentiment that would help Matthews cope with leaving the team that drafted him and his closest friends in the world. So there was tremendous pressure on Darby. Good thing he had talent. Bad luck that he got hurt in a non-contact injury. Later, it would become official. Darby out for months. But even before that realization, just moments after Darby was carted off the field, I could see one player urging his teammates on the sideline to rally to the cause, to close the deal, to get a road win at FedEx Field. It was veteran defensive end Chris Long, also in his first year with the team, the son of Hall of Fame pass rusher Howie Long, who had won a Super Bowl title in 2016 with the New England Patriots. Long and Patriots teammate LeGarrette Blount were brought in as Sunday mercenaries by Roseman to teach the Patriot way. Do your job. Find a way to win, no matter what the cost, no matter what the adversity.
"We got a game to play. Let's go," said Long, running onto the field. "Let's go make a play."
And foreshadowing what would happen 5 months later in Minneapolis, that's exactly what defensive end Brandon Graham did. With just 1 minute and 38 seconds left in the game, the Eagles led by less than a touchdown, 22-17. Redskins quarterback Kirk Cousins had just hit tight end Jordan Reed for a 7-yard gain. It was 2nd and 3, and Cousins again dropped back to pass. He'd already been sacked 3 times in the game. Here came another one. Graham bull-rushed the pocket and swiped at the football. A strip sack. The football landed gently in the lap of defensive tackle Fletcher Cox, who looked like Baloo in the Jungle Book as he danced happily to the end zone for a touchdown. There was a referee review. The play was upheld, and the Eagles erupted in joy, culminating in a Gatorade bath for Pederson. Mission accomplished. Road win in the division. And they had found something that would become imperative to building a championship team, a fourth-quarter pass rush. Defensive coordinator Jim Schwartz, the diabolical genius who doesn't mind you thinking he's a genius, had devised the perfect storm at exactly the right time with the right set of chess pieces. Graham had 2 sacks, 2 tackles for a loss against the run, and forced an offensive holding call.
That goes below the radar, Schwartz said. You force a quarterback into intentional grounding. You force an offensive lineman into a hold. Good players can do those kinds of things, and Brandon is a good player. Who sealed an important win. But the cost was high. Darby gone. Future Hall of Fame left tackle Jason Peters, who left the game early complaining of a groin injury, had an uncertain season ahead, and kicker Caleb Sturgis was done with some kind of mysterious hip injury. Nothing worse than having to look for a new kicker before you have to take on your old boss. Next up, Doug Peterson's mentor and confidant, Andy Reid, the Eagles' old head coach, on his turf. One important statistical note. Wentz attempted 6 passes that traveled at least 25 yards downfield against the Redskins, his career high for a game. The only other quarterback to attempt 6 such passes in Week 1? Tom Brady. Wentz completed just 1 of those 6 passes. So did Brady. The Patriots lost their game. The Eagles somehow won. But for both teams and both quarterbacks, it was the beginning of a year of throwing deep, a year when the two franchises were on parallel tracks that would turn into a collision course at the Super Bowl. Final score, Eagles 30, Redskins 17. Postscript. The day after the game, Doug Pederson made a comment that got very little attention. He said that early in the game, the Redskins did some stunts and games with their defensive line that were unscouted blitzes that resulted in a free pass rusher getting a clear shot at Wentz.
Carson's got to see it, said Pederson.
It was a rare example of the head coach publicly saying anything about Wentz that was critical in any way, shape, or form. Chapter 2. Exposing Big Red. The Eagles at the Chiefs, Sunday, September 17, 2017, Kansas City, Missouri. After beating the Patriots in Foxborough in the NFL opener, the Kansas City Chiefs under Andy Reid, known as Big Red for obvious reasons, were installed by Las Vegas as the favorite to win the Super Bowl. Just like that. Tom Brady was out, Alex Smith was in. But none of that concerned Doug Pederson. As he boarded the team flight for Kansas City, with the biggest road win of his young head coaching career now firmly planted at the top of his resume, the truth is that Pederson was under siege. You wouldn't know it by looking at him or hearing him in public, but that's just Peterson's personality and approach in life. He learned it at a very early age from his football coach, his father, Gordon. There is an old saying in the military, never let the troops see on your face how hard your ass is getting kicked. Same goes for the head coach or quarterback of a football team. You're the leader, Gordon would tell his son. You always will be the leader. Never let them see you sweat. There was no sweat, but there was plenty of seething anger. Once again, Peterson's credentials were being examined and dismissed. As a former player, he had seen it and heard it all before. Oh, he's just a career backup. In Green Bay, he's just Brett Favre's caddy. In Philadelphia, Pederson was there just to keep the seat warm until Reed's first draft pick, quarterback Donovan McNabb, was ready to take over as the starter. After his playing career was over, no NFL owner took him seriously. He went back to high school, Calvary Baptist Academy in Shreveport, Louisiana, to become the head coach. Total enrollment, 800 students. He toiled there 4 years before Reed brought him back to Philadelphia in 2009 as an offensive quality control coach. In Kansas City, he was again labeled a clipboard holder for Reed, who called the plays. He held the title of offensive coordinator for 3 years, but Pederson was dismissed. People said he had very little input into the Chiefs' offense and the success of the underrated quarterback Alex Smith. Pederson shrugged most of that off, but he heard it all. He doesn't care about that stuff, said a longtime friend. He just doesn't. He was happy in his marriage to his wife Jeannie. They were raising 3 healthy sons, Drew, Josh, and Joel, and now he had one of the 32 most prestigious jobs in America, NFL head coach. But on the doorstep of his second season, it all got too personal.
It started even before the season got underway. One name that would echo throughout the NovaCare building, throughout the city, Mike Lombardi. Lombardi, the former general manager of the Cleveland Browns, hired by owner Jimmy Haslam after receiving the highest possible recommendation from Lombardi's friend and mentor Bill Belichick, had been out of the NFL, trying to remain relevant in the ongoing pro football conversation in the mainstream media. Here's what Lombardi said about Pederson in a TheRinger.com video, in all its glory.
My beloved 76ers once hired a guy by the name of Roy Rubin from Long Island University. Poor Roy. He finished 4-47 before the Sixers canned him. 4-47! Years later, Fred Carter said, letting Rubin coach was like letting a teenager run a big corporation. Hey, Fred, meet the Eagles head coach Doug Pederson. Now, everybody knows Pederson isn't a head coach. He might be less qualified to coach a team than anyone I've ever seen in my 30-plus years in the NFL. Pederson was barely a coordinator before he became head coach. Can you imagine if we elected a United States president who didn't have any real training? Sorry, don't answer that. Look, the Eagles looked increasingly sloppy and unprepared as the 2016 season limped along. That ain't changing in 17. Only Carson Wentz can save Peterson's job. And Wentz actually got worse during his rookie year, not better. When will the Eagles admit their mistake? When will they throw away 2017 by stubbornly sticking to the Pederson principle? The immortal Roy Rubin lasted 51 games. I bet Doug Pederson lasts way less than that.
That is a full-throttle put-down, and it came on the eve of the season opener. The timing and the comparison to the lowly Philadelphia 76ers, who had been insulting Philly fans for years by deliberately tanking with little to show for it, was undoubtedly intentional. The next day, Pederson got a flood of outraged texts from friends and family. Privately, he tried to explain it away, justify it as a non-factor in the totality of his life. But of course it hurt. It hurt because he had heard the same thing for years. Still, he was determined to ignore it by pretending that he didn't know anything about it.
I haven't seen the article. I'm not sure what you're talking about, so I don't pay attention to that, Pederson said 6 days before the team played the Redskins in the opener.
Then he revealed that it clearly bothered him.
He's not in the building, Pederson added, referring to Lombardi. I coach our coaches and coach our players. I haven't read the article.
A reporter filled him in. How do you respond to that notion about your qualifications?
Someone here thought I was qualified, he responded. That's good enough for me. Ask the guys in the locker room.
The locker room was a boiling cauldron of disgust. The players, most of whom live nonstop on Instagram and Twitter, had circulated the Lombardi comments and were exchanging expletive-laden responses to each other, the coaching staff, and Pederson. This dude takes so much crap, one player said to me in the locker room, only he didn't say crap.
It's bull. That guy Lombardi ought to show his face around here.
All year, center Jason Kelsey would simply say to people who asked, that clown Lombardi. Someone suggested they make T-shirts, just like the one Patriots defensive coordinator Matt Patricia wore of Roger Goodell wearing a red clown nose after the Deflategate fiasco. But it was shot down. We're not the Patriots, one player said. They hate on people. We don't. At least, in public. The following week, it got worse. This time, the insinuation of Pederson's incompetence was incubated from within the team's practice facility, and it would start a cold war with the Philly media that would linger all season. Jim Schwartz played linebacker at Georgetown University, not a football powerhouse. It's a basketball school synonymous with names like Iverson, Ewing, and Thompson. Not Schwartz playing linebacker. But you don't get into Georgetown unless you've got some seriously killer SAT scores. And while he was playing football, Jim Schwartz got a degree in economics. He was an academic All-American. He could have joined a major think tank or put on a military uniform and made a fine officer.
Noted author Mike Freeman, who went to high school with Schwartz in Maryland, said, "He'd kick your ass and outthink you while doing it." Schwartz thought about going to law school, but his passion was football, especially the angles and instantaneous reactions needed to play defense against an NFL quarterback. Problem was, his style was the opposite of Peterson's. He was smarter than you, and he didn't have to tell you he was. You figured out the minute he walked into the room. His face and walk said it all. Swagger. Pederson wanted to show you how much he cared before he told you what he knew. Schwartz cared. But it took a while for you to figure that out. It's easy to see why Schwartz, former defensive coordinator in Tennessee and head coach in Detroit, was in NFL exile for a year when Pederson hired him in 2016. He's an acquired taste, but boy can he coach defense. He learned from the best, maybe the best ever, Bill Belichick. Belichick gave him his first NFL job, evaluating players with the Cleveland Browns in the mid-1990s. Are you connecting the dots here? Browns? Lombardi? Schwartz? Just as the controversy over Lombardi subsided, the Philadelphia Inquirer published a story that insinuated that Schwartz was quietly positioning himself behind the scenes to be the next head coach of the Eagles if Pederson failed. Without comment from Pederson or Schwartz, a fact that angered the Eagles organization, the story, which came out the day before the Eagles took the field in Washington, said Schwartz was walking around the NovaCare complex like he owned the place. The story said, "At the very least, the optics aren't favorable." One Eagle staffer said the only coach who probably doesn't think Schwartz is trying to undercut Pederson is Pederson. Three players, who requested anonymity, said that it has become well known in the locker room that Schwartz is waiting to usurp power. Interestingly, at three successive press conferences, Pederson was never asked for a reaction, even by the reporter who wrote it. The guy who worked more closely with Pederson than anyone in the building, offensive coordinator Frank Reich, wasn't asked about it either. Only Schwartz. He was asked to confirm or deny a report he had nothing to do with, and after the story came out. He was guilty of being arrogant, sure, but that's always been the rap on him. But undercutting Pederson? No way. In fact, just a few minutes before he talked to the media on September 12, 2017, Schwartz was in the cafeteria at NovaCare having lunch and he saw a player in violation of Pederson's dress code. Pederson was not around, so Schwartz stepped in.
"Coach Pederson has a rule in the cafeteria that you can't wear tank tops or no sleeves," he said. "He wasn't in the cafeteria when I was. There was an offensive player that had no sleeves on. So I tapped him and said, 'You've got to get out. You've got to get sleeves on.' I know that when I was head coach, I wanted people around the building that were enforcing my rules. I did that for him. I respect that position. I'm going to execute the job the way that he outlined it for me. I think anything else we can't really worry about."
Bad optics or not, the players again reacted to the story and were motivated by it. They all say they don't listen to talk radio or pay attention to social media, but most of them do. Tight end Zach Ertz was clear they heard about the article and were annoyed, twice in 1 week.
"There was a lot of hoopla with the article that came out before the game, which was very unfortunate that it came out the day before the game like that," he said.
Getting ready to play his old boss, Pederson told his team in a meeting on Wednesday before the game to tune out the outside noise. That was 5 days before kickoff at Arrowhead Stadium. The night before, in the team hotel in Kansas City, Pederson stood before his players and warned them what was coming. The Chiefs, he reminded them, had just waltzed into the home of the world champs, the Patriots, and beat them, spoiled their opener before their home fans at Gillette Stadium, where the hopes and dreams of an AFC title normally go to die. So, he said he had two clear, easy messages. On offense, we need to protect the football better, and on defense, we need to take it away. In the first half against the Chiefs, the Eagles did not do either one. Philadelphia fumbled twice, punt returner Darren Sproles losing one. But Schwartz's defense had confounded Reed's play calling. Alex Smith was sacked 3 times in just 18 pass attempts in the first half. Pederson's crew was on a mission to prove they belonged with the big boys of the NFL. In the halftime locker room, not much was said, except safety Malcolm Jenkins going around preaching the same thing over and over.
We got this! We got this!
The defense had held the Chiefs' high-flying offense, with rookie speedster Kareem Hunt, the running back out of Toledo, and the pyrotechnic wide receiver Tyreek Hill, to just 2 field goals. It was 6-3 Chiefs. Pederson told Wentz one thing, we're going to keep firing. And that's what he did to open the second half. 5 of the next 6 plays were passes. Nothing doing. Eagles had to punt. But the defense held. And when the Eagles got the ball back, Pederson just flat out refused to run the football. He smelled blood. He wanted to beat his old boss. He wanted to prove to his critics and the doubters that his team was totally legit. Right now. He called 4 more pass plays in a row. Gains of 18, 11, 11, and 14 yards. Wentz, who had quietly asked Pederson for more autonomy at the line of scrimmage getting in and out of plays, was just letting it fly, without regard for his body, taking shot after shot. He had the Eagles on the Chiefs' 16-yard line. Reed's defense was on the ropes. 1 more pass play. Wentz to Alshon Jeffrey, 16 yards, touchdown. The Eagles finally had the lead, but not for long. 5 plays later, Hunt gashed the Eagles right up the middle, a majestic sprint of 53 yards and a touchdown. The Eagles tied the score when the new kicker Jake Elliott hit a 40-yarder. Here it was, 13-13, 11 minutes and 57 seconds left in the game, and this upstart team had laid bare for all to see that the Chiefs could be beat. The Eagles were on the cusp of taking out the team that Vegas had anointed the new NFL darlings. And that's when it all came apart. When the Eagles got the ball back, Pederson went back to the passing game, back to his second-year quarterback. But without a reliable running game, running backs coach Deuce Staley was inexplicably determined to stick with second-year back Wendell Smallwood, the Chiefs kept coming after number 11, and he was intercepted at the Eagles' 28-yard line. Smith hit Jason Kelce's brother, the mercurial tight end Travis Kelce, for a 15-yard touchdown, and that was it. 1 more score, and the Chiefs walked away with a win. And all the questions about Pederson and his ability to call a game and be an NFL head coach were left wide open for another painful week. The day after the game, back in Philadelphia, in the huge auditorium the Eagles use for team meetings and press conferences, adorned with wall-sized photographs of 4 legends, Chuck Bednarik, Tommy McDonald, Reggie White, and Steve Van Buren, Doug Pederson was treated like a washed-up middleweight by the Philly media. In short, he was interrogated. In a foreshadowing of things to come, Pederson talked about run-pass options, RPOs, and whether they represented a good approach for Wentz.
A lot of Carson's runs came on scrambles, Pederson said. One of the things we did with Alex Smith, obviously, was more RPOs, where he could utilize that athleticism. We haven't done it as much with Carson at this time.
It wasn't because Wentz wasn't as athletic as Smith. Quite the opposite. Pederson didn't want to introduce RPOs to Wentz. He was already running too much, and taking as many hits as he was taking was not sustainable. That was the decision made privately among the coaches. It was something Pederson would later introduce for Nick Foles as a way of loosening up the defenses against him in the final 4 weeks of the season after Wentz blew out his knee. But the first 3 rapid-fire questions put to Pederson were all about how and why Pederson thought he could possibly win on the road by throwing the ball so much, ignoring the running game and relying on Smallwood and Sproles while making LeGarrette Blount such an afterthought. No answer Pederson gave was going to repel the attacks. He gave it a try, but the truth is he'd had enough of the press corps already, after the Lombardi and Schwartz stories, and it was only week 2. So he began to sort of sleepwalk through some shop-worn responses. Coach speak.
My aggressive play calling was down the field and to attack down the field, he explained.
Later that night, he would admit to me,
We've got to get the run game fixed. We all know that. Too many third and longs. We had 7 third and 10+ downs in this game. If that happens, they're going to tee off on our quarterback all game.
As the late great Hall of Fame quarterback Ken the Snake Stabler of the Oakland Raiders and the University of Alabama used to say, with that gentle southern drawl and a grin, too many third and longs will make you sleep on your side of the bed. One important statistical note. After two games, 74.4% of the Eagles' offensive snaps were designed pass plays, the second highest rate in the NFL. Under Pederson, Philadelphia was 6-2 when it ran the ball on at least 40% of dropbacks, but 2-8 when it didn't. Time to find balance, or Pederson would squander what was clearly developing into a championship-level defense, and Wentz would not survive. On the plane ride back to Philadelphia, Pederson sat alone for most of the flight, watching the game over and over on his iPad. Despite the loss, he was actually encouraged by several trends that he thought showed the offense was getting better. The Wentz connection with Jeffrey showed better timing. Ertz was filling in for the absence of Jordan Matthews. Nelson Agholor was getting open. So, while he was talking about balance, Pederson was trying to figure out how to unleash the power of a special group that he thought had the potential to win a lot of football games, which is exactly what was about to happen. Final score, Chiefs 27, Eagles 20. Postscript. Before the season started, Carson Wentz said the toughest part of adjusting to the professional game from North Dakota State was only really difficult in one area. It was not the speed of the game, which is something all rookies say. No, he said, it was the exotic looks and pressures of different defensive coordinators. The Chiefs' defensive coordinator, Bob Sutton, had just confounded Wentz, who held his own to a certain extent. Next up was the first guy to beat Brady and Belichick in a Super Bowl, New York Giants defensive coordinator Steve Spagnuolo, who began his NFL coaching career with the Eagles. Chapter 3. Malcolm in the Middle. The Giants at the Eagles. Sunday, September 24, 2017. South Philadelphia. 2 days before the Eagles' home opener, the NFL season was hijacked by the President of the United States. And right away, Doug Pederson knew he had to stay out of it. Let the players decide what to do. After all, it was the players who felt they had been insulted by Donald Trump. They didn't need anybody else telling them how to respond. There was another critical reason why Pederson didn't need to lead here. He had Malcolm Jenkins. It would not be the first time Malcolm Jenkins showed the way, and it would not be the last. You've all heard the cliche, this guy is the heart and soul of this football team. Well, in this case, it was not a cliche. It was just fact. In the first Super Bowl championship season of the long, star-crossed history of a franchise dating back to 1933, Malcolm Jenkins was the heart and soul of the Philadelphia Eagles. He was the leader of Doug Pederson's Players Council. He was the leader of Jim Schwartz's defense. He was the spokesman for the team, on the field, in the locker room, and in the Philadelphia community. He met with the city's police chief, spoke at schools, and cared for distressed children. He was a philanthropist and a businessman. And when the mood struck him, Malcolm Jenkins could knock the snot out of you. Just ask Brandon Cooks. So, when the President of the United States decided to flex his political muscle and inject himself into the roiling debate over whether NFL players should be forced to stand for the national anthem, there was only one guy who had the moral authority to lead.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.